And we are rolling on March 14th, Cameron Bagai's birthday. Who's that? Yeah, who dat? Okay. Alexandria T. Okay, let's have you do topic number one. My biggest resource is my mind by Kareem Abdul-Jabbar, also known as Lew Alcindor. Can you step a half step forward and talk from there? Thank you.
Before I start, I want you guys to imagine your most favorite memory. The best thing that's ever happened to you, something that brings you an immense amount of joy, and just your favorite memory. And I want you guys to hold on to that memory while I speak on UCLA alum and former basketball player Kareem Abdul-Jabbar. And his quote that his mind is his greatest resource. Today I want to argue that Mr. Jabbar is actually correct. And I am going to use three stories to demonstrate that. First story will be on Harry Potter and how memories that his professor's mind stored actually were the key for him to defeat Voldemort. My next story is about Kareem Abdul-Jabbar himself, and how his mind allowing him to think critically allowed him to become one of the most influential people in America. And the final story is on all of us and how our minds is the reason why we are sitting here today. We all have minds, and I hope we all know how important they are to us, so I think they all, knowing how important they are is good for us. So I'm going to start with the story of Harry Potter. So Harry Potter is a wizard who goes to school in the Hogwarts School of Wizards, witchcraft and wizardry, and his main goal is to defeat the greatest, meanest, evilest wizard, Voldemort. And in book six, movie six, he and his mentor Dumbledore are having a hard time figuring out how to defeat him. And they don't know how to kill him. The key is actually stored in his Professor Slughorn's mind. When Harry Potter acquires these memories, he actually gets to know how to defeat him, and the only reason to defeat Voldemort is to destroy six other things, and then you can destroy him. So I would argue that actually these memories that he acquired, that our mind keeps, were actually the key for him to destroy Voldemort. If he'd never known, if he'd never seen these memories, he wouldn't have been able to kill him. Next, I will tell you guys about Kareem Abdul-Jabbar himself, and how when he was a freshman at UCLA, he read a book by Malcolm X, which started making him think about race and prejudice in America, and started making him think critically about our society. When he turned 24, he converted to Islam and changed his name to Kareem Abdul-Jabbar in order to demonstrate how Islam is the only faith that he feels that embraces his Black American heritage. So he kept devoting his life to activism for Islam and Black Americans, which he ended up, last year, he ended up receiving the Presidential Medal of Freedom, which is the highest civilian honor. And he didn't only receive the medal for his skills on the basketball court, he also received it for his influence on American society. He had a huge influence on the Black American community and people who practice Islam. So this is an example of his mind allowing him to think critically of our society and being able to change it. My final point is the fact that we are all sitting here today. Our minds actually allow us to have emotions and actually allow us to care about stuff. So I'm pretty sure you all remember when you were writing the personal statements to get into UCLA, how extremely hard it was and how many drafts you actually had to make in order to make a good enough one to submit. If our brains didn't allow us to care, and you didn't really care about getting into UCLA, you wouldn't have written that draft in the first place. It takes a lot of work to get in here. We all have to study a lot, we have to get A's, and if you don't really care about, you know, getting into UCLA, getting into college, you won't really work hard for it. Also, the fact that you all are sitting here today means that you actually care. You care about this class, you care about getting a nice grade, and we have our minds to think for that. So, in summary, Kareem Abdul-Jabbar is correct that our minds are our greatest resource. I demonstrated that through the story of Harry Potter, through Kareem Abdul-Jabbar's life himself, and how we are here today. I want you guys to remember that memory that I told you about in the beginning, and I want you guys to imagine not being able to remember that memory at all or the joy that it brings you. Furthermore, I want you guys to think about not remembering anything ever again, because that will be our reality without our minds. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Five what?
30.
5:30. Thank you. What'd you like, old timer?
Hi, Monique. Hi. I liked the examples you did because they covered, like, one was more contemporary, one was historical, and one, like, involved everybody, so I liked your range of examples. Mm-hmm. Also, when you speak, it's like very calming, and I still listen to this one.
Okay. Improvement? Yeah.
Hello, my name is Marcos. I really like
Hi, Marcos.
Hey. I really liked your speech. I felt like maybe you could have done like maybe a little bit of a deeper analysis of your examples. I felt like a lot of it was like really rooted in cliches. But that was pretty good though.
Okay, fair enough. Well, Alexandria, or do you go by Alex?
Yes. Alex.
Kareem said his mind, my biggest resource is my mind, and he clearly gave examples of resources. He resourced his mind, and in the Potter example, and in Kareem, you gave his example of converting to Islam and reading Malcolm X's book. Yes, I too thought you could have had a little more meat on the bone with your analysis and your examples and presented them a little more deeply. When you watch yourself tonight on YouTube, you'll see that you kept your hands behind your back like you were inspecting the troops like Napoleon for the first two examples, and then you finally remembered and brought your hands out and did some nice gesturing. Remember to let your hands be free the whole speech. That's going to be much better. You use the memory, eyes closed, and not having your mind, not having that ability. That was okay. I like that okay. Work on, I would say also, you know, be careful. You do have what was described as a calming tone, but you want to have a variety in that so that you don't, you know, lull people to sleep. I don't mean to imply you're boring, but just you are soothing to listen to.
Okay.
And so you break in some louder, softer, faster, slower, and then that keeps it interesting to listen to. Okay? Mm-hmm. Thank you very much. Nice job. Okay. New page. Shania Hunt.
Already went last week.
Well, lucky you. Good old Shania. Lindsay Allen. Lindsay Allen. Zero?
There.
Oh, I worry you didn't show.
I showed.
She showed. Now show me an outline.
Oh, of the speech or of my...
Oh, you don't have to show me an outline. Okay. I misspoke.
Okay.
Yeah, you're fine. Okay, Lindsay Allen stands before us. As speaker 6. Okay, Lindsay, as you probably suspect, I'd like to hear you talk on topic 2. And topic 2 by Frank Gehry says, those who say only artists and architects can create are the ones who are elitist. I repeat, those who say only artists and architects can create are the ones who are elitist.
And who's taking time? So.
Who's taking times?
Okay,
the same person
everything.
That's always been taking
go.
Times.
Cool. Thank you. Cool. I'm an avid Warriors basketball fan, so naturally, I take a lot of flack. I hear it all. Kevin Durant the cupcake. Riley Curry isn't even cute. And yesterday in the library, I saw etched on the desk, the Warriors blew a 3-1 lead. I moved. While I rise above it, because I realize it's rooted in jealousy. I can continue on and talk about Steph's phenomenal shooting percentage, Draymond's assist record, and a multitude of other awesome efficiencies. But really what it comes down to is great coaching. Steve Kerr has sculpted one of the most formidable and entertaining teams to watch in modern sports history. And watching the swift and cohesive movement across the court is anything shy of art. So not acquiescing. To Frank Gehry's very poignant quote, those who say only artists and architects are the ones who can create are those who are elitists, I disagree. While good intentioned, and perhaps in practice we might be saying the same thing, I think he definitionally narrows the focus of what it means to be an artist and an architect. I believe anyone who can create an emotional and emotive experience for another individual is an artist. And if you've ever seen me watch a Warriors game, you would describe it as emotional. So I'll talk about this in the context of 3 different things. Chef's Table, a critique of the Myers-Briggs personality test, and ultimately a program that's near and dear to my heart, Girls Who Code. Some background on Gehry, he is a famous architect who denounces his own stardom, something I find ironically elitist. It's tradition, it's risen in the rise of the modern art and hyper-realist, impressionist, and all of the ism movements of art for artists. It's the desire for traditional artists to separate themselves from the masses. What I'd like to do today is bring the art to the masses. So let's talk about Chef's Table, a docu-series on Netflix, which I highly recommend to anyone who enjoys food and great cinematography. The intention of the docu-series is to bring artistry to the realm of cooking. Take, for example, Dominique Lacrenne, a French chef in San Francisco, the only female chef with 2 Michelin stars. She describes her food as something that reminds her of her late and great father in the suburbs of France. Food critics have described her food as so emotional that it makes them and incentivizes them to actually travel to the suburbs of France, her own hometown. An experience that is that visceral, it would be disenfranchising not to label this chef as an artist. So Chef's Table is ultimately bringing that artistry to this realm of cooking. Next, moving on to the Myers-Briggs personality test. If you've ever taken it, it labels you as 4 letters, starting with E or I for extrovert or introvert, and so on. I'm labeled an ENTJ, essentially an extrovert who thinks at a high level and makes their decisions off of judgment and rationale. Where I accept the compliment that it is someone who is a leader, traditionally non-aesthetic, not really an artist. Artists are generally labeled with ISFP, people who make decisions off of feeling and perceiving. So it is my argument that any institution that codifies this Myers-Briggs personality test into their curricula is setting up a self-fulfilling prophecy that inhibits people from expanding their own horizons. I want to reject a culture in which I can't be labeled an artist. While my stick figures do need some work, I'd like to have at least the potential to become that artist. Moving on, let's talk about something that's near and dear to my heart. That is Girls Who Code, a program that brings together young, feisty 12-year-old girls who I get the pleasure of mentoring. They tell me about their woes in math and science classes, being told, wow, you're smart for a girl. Something that's strikingly not uncommon for women in math and science. Something that is, and what Girls Who Code aims to do is relabel what it means to be an engineer or a scientist. Changing face so that you're not a female engineer or a girl in medicine, but you're simply a doctor, period. And it's programs like these where awesome and creative initiatives like STEAM come about. That is an edit of STEM: science, technology, engineering, art, and math. And this is the root of innovation and the betterment for society. These are where ideas come to fruition and benefit the whole, is reinventing and reimagining our traditional definitions of things like engineer, scientist, and in this context, the artist. So while Frank Gehry had good intentions with his quote, I disagree with him definitionally on what it means to be an artist and an architect. So yes, at the end of the day, my definition means that we all can be artists. So I would recommend to you going ahead, think of yourself as an artist, and my final recommendation would be to watch the Warriors game tonight at 7:30. Thank you.
Thank you. Time? 5:55. Okay, where are we? We're here.
Hi, I'm Arthur. I really liked your speech,
Arthur.
And I liked your introduction. It was very humorous, and also I liked your gestures. You were gesturing a lot, which was establishing the connection with the audience.
Improvement?
I'm a Cavs fan, so I'm glad you gave an example. Other than that, I thought it was great.
I'm a cash man?
A Cavalier man.
Oh, I see.
But, yeah, other than that, maybe a little more vocal intonation or something here or there. But other than that, it was great.
Yeah, interesting. Lindsay, I liked your speech. I read the quote differently than you did, but I think we're on the same page. I thought that Gehry was saying the same thing you were saying, that in the part where he says only artists and architects can create, and you were saying no chefs can create, and people that write good tests can create, and people that work with young feisty girls can create. Gary wouldn't disagree with you, but maybe I'm reading it wrong. You did a good job of sharing your passion with the Warriors. That got us all kind of interested. And I like the little writing on the wall that you had to move or on the desk or something. I guess this is a passion of people, and I like the way you described the great coaching of the director of the program. So that was good. You clearly took a position, and you had a good preview, and you elaborated on it with 3 points that made your position clear, that non-traditional artists are doing a lot of good creating. And so I think you made that point strongly. A little bit more of the narrative come out. Second reason, and the third example, you know, like that. Summary, conclusion, and your tie back to the Warriors was good. What were you trying to accomplish? What goals were you looking to achieve this time?
To get people to rethink the definition of an artist. Because originally when I wrote the speech, I just plainly agreed with him, but because I think at the end of the day, we both have the same views and that everyone can create.
Yeah.
But so like the practical application is the same. But in terms of the verbiage of the quote, I disagree with how
he said it. Yeah,
how he says it. Yeah.
Great. Okay, well, you did a nice job. Thank you. Okay. Next page. James. James S. Okay, James S. Let me take a look at your choices there, James. Yeah. Let's hear you talk about, quote, number 3 from Gloria Steinem. Gloria said, "The art of life is not controlling what happens to us, but using what happens to us." I repeat, the art of life is not controlling what happens to us, but using what happens to us. I guess we'll have to have that front door shut, I guess. Probably. Thank you. Boy, I got a mouth on him. Yeah, that's good. Just, yeah. Okay, James. James S., rock and roll.
All right. The quote here is, "The art of life is not controlling what happens to us, but using what happens to us," by Gloria Steinem. Thank you, Professor. I really like this actual quote. Like, I think it's a powerful quote, personally, because it kind of talks about things like within our control and not in our control, right? And like, if we have a firm grasp on any of these things, it can make life a lot more better for us in the long run. I mean, we have to think about things out of our control, right? For one instance, what's out of your control is how people look at you, right? No matter what, you can be the nicest person in the world, people still may judge you or not like you. You can't control traffic here in LA. We all wish we could, but we just can't, right? You can't control human nature. Wish we could control that, right? But here's some of the things we can't control. We can control our gratitude. We can control how many risks we take, and we can control how many times we say thank you to somebody. You know, so so basically, I want to talk about three situations where people kind of had something to happen to them, and they took control of the situation. One is a man named Clark Gregg. He's an actor. Second is a situation that happened to me personally. And third, I want to talk about a man named Kevin who works in the restaurant industry. First, I want to talk about this gentleman by the name of Clark Gregg. He was born in Boston, and he was really into the acting world. And what happens is in the early 80s, 1983, he formed Atlantic Acting Company with William H. Macy from Shameless and David Mamet, like this Pulitzer Prize winning guy, Always Be Closing, if you know that movie. But what happens is he was doing bit parts here and there, doing a lot of theater, but mostly bit parts and film and TV. He didn't really book a lot of work at a certain point of his career, and as he said, he couldn't get arrested, right? So what he decided to do was he started working for development companies and just script reading, right? And script reading, never wrote a script in his life, but he said after reading all these scripts, like, you know what, I could do this too. Let me at least try. And he did that, and his first script was a movie by the name of What Lies Beneath. And it started Harrison Ford and Michelle Pfeiffer. And what that did for him, it earned over $150 million domestically. And it also put his at least name on the map to a certain extent. It didn't make him like a household name, but he started getting bigger bit parts. And eventually he starred in a movie called Iron Man across Robert Downey Jr. As if you know, it's Agent Coulson. And after that, he became a household name in the comic book genre of like comics and comic films. And now he's on television, and he probably has like a whole bunch of assistants now. So that's one thing that was good. Second, I want to talk about myself personally. When I moved here, I'm from Texas initially, and when I moved here, I attended Los Angeles Valley College, and I just wanted to go there and get like a two-year degree. And associates, but at a certain point my counselor said, hey James, you should apply to UCLA. And I said, okay, why not? You know, I was making good grades at the time. So I applied. No other school I applied to. I said, I'm getting into this school, whatever it takes. Anyway, a few months later I find out I didn't get in, right? And I was like, okay, well forget this. I'm not even, like, I've just actually decided not to go to school anymore. So I quit school for a semester, started working full-time, and after semester, after being disillusioned, I said, you know what, let me go back, I'm going to finish my degree, and I'll apply to the Cal States. Those are accredited universities, they're just as good. So I came back, did my grades, did my thing, and I applied to those, and then I saw that counselor again, and she says, James, you should apply again. I said, lady, you crazy. That's not happening. Like, I'm not putting myself out there again. And basically, I went home and slept on it. When I came back, I said, you know what, I'll apply. I had 1 week to apply to. This is at the end of the year. So I did that, and then fast forward a few months, I got accepted to all the Cal States I applied to, and I got accepted to UCLA on my birthday. And it was like the best birthday gift ever. Thirdly, I want to talk about a man by the name of Kevin Oksaki. He's from Brazil. And he grew up on a rural farm in Brazil. And what he wanted to do was come to America. He really wanted to come here. Didn't speak a lick of English. And when he moved here, he started taking English classes, and he was mopping floors at Denny's, right? Mopping floors at Denny's. But one thing he did, he loved to cook. And he loved to cook, and he had this passion for it. So eventually he met his future husband. And his husband knew how much he loved to cook, and he knew how good his food was. So eventually they got married and they opened up a small business together. Like one of those small storefronts you see, restaurants, seat less than 10 people. Anyway, the food was good, but he had a certain setback. Him and the husband, they broke up. They separated. So he was down and out. At one point he thought about going back to Brazil because he's like, you know, I lost the love of my life. And but some investors really liked their food. And they said they wanted to invest, and he worked out something with the husband when they separated. Husband kind of put off his stake of the company and let Kevin have it. And at this point, after the investors got it, they moved to Glendale, bigger steakhouse, and like now it's like one of the top restaurants in that city. And that was another kind of experience for him. So basically, basically what it's talking about is the art of life is not controlling what happens to us, but using what happens to us. Clark used his situation, in a sense, where his career wasn't going the right way. I used a situation where school may have not worked out exactly how I planned it, but I came back stronger and really just kind of re-upped myself and say, you know what, you can always try again, even if you fall on your face. And then Kevin, coming from this country and having some success here, but then falling down, he still picked himself back up and he found his own version of success. At the end of the day, it's not about the outcome, but it's more so about the output from us. And we're capable of so many things as long as we believe in ourselves. Thank you.
Time.
6:40.
Thank you. Where are we? Are we here? Have you? Yeah.
Really like your speech.
Name?
Alexandra.
Hi, Alexandra.
I like the stories that you had. I liked your personal story. I thought that was really vivid and nice. And, yes, good.
Okay, thank you, Alexandra. Improvement?
Hi, I'm Vidya.
Hi, Vidya.
I really don't have much to say about your speech. I thought it was really good. Maybe the significant statement, but not really. Like, I didn't even notice. I just had to say something.
Right. James, pretty good speech. Like to see you cleave to the outline given, not religiously, but somewhat, so we kind of know where you're going and what you're going to do, and a significant statement. You did, in the main body, make your point with three examples, which were good ones. I would have liked you doubled back at the very end to give the moral and connect it to the thesis of the quote. I would have liked to have had it done too in the body, so when you finish with Clark Gray, we could have had a little summing up of what Clark did with his script reading and how he took what he got and turned it, you know, got a lemon, made lemonade, and that sort of thing. Your personal story was very inspiring and good and very memorable, and so I think it was the kind of thing we're trying to do with our sticky texts, to make them more sticky, so there's a certain stickiness here that happened. And then the restaurant was a good story, too. Again, the moral could have been a little stronger. And then, so in summary, 3:32, in conclusion, say it again, and then a tie back to an intro of not just the quote, but some other clever thing. And then that really works well that way. Say one more thing. And I don't know that you necessarily had to do this, but this was by Gloria Steinem, a feminist, and I didn't know if you wanted to go down that road or not, or talk about some of the personal setbacks she's had in her life and how she's made good on it. She started as a Playboy bunny working for Hugh Hefner and evolved into an icon of feminism and so forth, but I don't know. I just you've seen other people sort of
use the
author as sort of a, you know, who's Gloria Steinem, you know. So anyway, nice job. Thank you. Okay, back to page one. Arthur! Oscar, what's your last name?
Azeev. A-Z-I-E-V.
A-Z-I-V?
E-V.
Okay. Thank you. Okay, I'd like you to talk about quote number one from Kareem Abdul-Jabbar. You play with your soul as well as your body. He said you play with your soul as well as your body.
Hi, my name is Arthur, and I'd like to ask you a question of, do you have a profession of your dream, a field of work that you have, that you're so passionate about and that you're so interested about? In case if you do, your choices are very broad. You can choose to be associated with the legal field. You can try to become the next U.S. Supreme Court Justice. In case if you're interested in medicine, you can try to become a surgeon or try to develop the new vaccine to battle different diseases. In case if you're interested in engineering, you might be passionate about improving the efficiency of the automobile engines. And to be honest with you, it doesn't really matter what you choose because your choice doesn't matter what it is. It is driven by your soul. It is driven by your passions. It is driven by your interests in this field. You think that you are able to succeed in this field by pushing yourself out of the comfort zone and expanding your frontiers of expertise in this field. Today I want to talk to you about a quote by Kareem Abdul-Jabbar, who is a 6-time NBA champion and an NBA legend, who said that you play with your soul as well as with your body. Now, when speaking of significance of this quote, it is crucial to realize that it has universal applicability and is applicable to each and every one of us in this classroom. When Kareem Abdul-Jabbar is saying that you play with your soul, by play he means you can also live with your soul as well as with your body. It doesn't matter whether you're an athlete or a person in a usual field of expertise, you can still be this quote can still be applicable to your life. Now, I would like to elaborate on 3 important examples that will try to understand how this quote applies to our lives. And the first example is of a famous athlete, a world champion in boxing. His name is Mike Tyson. He became, he's known for being the youngest heavyweight champion of the world in boxing. Second example is a rather controversial example of a person who gained his popularity within the last several years. His name is Edward Snowden. And the second example, and the third example, the last one, is an individual who is considered as one of the most talented composers and pianists to ever live. Now, starting with the first example of Mike Tyson, who became the youngest world champion in heavyweight division. He became a champion at the age of 20 years old, and he was born in a very poor neighborhood. Was picked up by his trainer Cosmodo and trained to become a world superstar. Whenever Mike Tyson was asked or praised about his talent or about his career, he was saying that, "I'm passionate about boxing. I love doing what I do the best. I love to fight." And in order to understand his perception, his mentality of boxing, it's important to see how dedicated he was to his craft and what are the quotes that he was, what are the statements that he was making regarding himself and his talent. Moreover, besides the quote that I just mentioned, Mike Tyson was saying that, "I love to hit people. This is my passion." I mean, jokes aside, it might sound like a very funny quote. It is crucial to see that Mike Tyson was able to perform not only thanks to his physical extraordinary talent, he was able to play, he was able to box through his soul. Now, the second example that I would like to mention is a more controversial example, as I was saying. It doesn't really matter whether you consider this person a traitor or a person who is fighting for the right to privacy. His name is Edward Snowden. He gains his popularity as a result of leaking classified information, which was providing evidence that the United States government was imposing surveillance programs against criminals as well as law-abiding citizens. Now, when Edward Snowden himself acknowledges the fact that he leaked the information, he explained it as he was driven by his conscience, saying that whenever you see that a person, whenever you see that a wrongdoing is done by the government, and you stand by only thanks to the threat of self-destruction, this is immoral, and this goes against my personal beliefs. In the example of Edward Snowden, relating back to the quote by Kareem Abdul-Jabbar, he was playing not only with his body, which is represented by his brain and intellectual capacity to perform the necessary work, he was also thinking with his soul. He was thinking through his moral preconceptions and moral belief system. He was saying that he cannot spy on law-abiding citizens, and as a result, he quit CIA and leaked the information to the public. The third example that I'd like to mention is an example of one of the greatest composers, pianists. His name is Ludwig von Beethoven. He is praised for many of his works, such as piano sonatas and symphonies. And it is true that a lot of people who had a chance to listen to his music say that Beethoven's music provokes one of the most interesting, one of the most complex emotions that are in our conscious, such as anger, love, peace, and grievance. And if you had a chance to listen to his music, you would probably agree that this is the case. Whenever you listen to Beethoven's music, you can see his soul, you can feel his soul, and what he was feeling at the moment of writing this music. In the year of 1816, Beethoven faced a very unfortunate circumstance in his life, and he became deaf. He was not able to hear to speech, and he was not able to listen to the piano. Even after this, he continued to give the humanity with new works, which were praised even more than his previous ones. The new one that he wrote after becoming deaf was called Missa Solemnis, and which gained large-scale popularity among all the countries across the globe. We can see that Ludwig von Beethoven did not stop being loyal to his passion, did not stop using his soul to write his music, but instead used even more effort to come up with better ideas, with better music, and as a result gifted the world one of the most appreciated works of music. In summary, I've shown you I've talked about three examples that really show how the quote by Kareem Abdul-Jabbar, which says that you play with your soul as well as with your body, relates to each and every one of us. It really tells us that we have to remember it's not only about our looks, it's not only about our physical performance. Soul is also very important. It's our moral beliefs, it's our belief system that we associate with, and and whenever you're thinking of doing something new and taking up new challenges, just think about how to use your soul to help you accomplish your tasks. Thank you.
Thank you. Time? 7:70?
7:17.
I liked your variety of different examples. The Edward Snowden example was pretty good, and I think that you gave a pretty good brief background on each example before kind of tying it back into your talk.
Thank
you. Hello, I'm David.
Hi, David.
I would like more tones, more variation, more up and down in volume and tonality and emotive qualities of your voice.
Thank you, David. Those are good suggestions. Arthur. Well, I was curious as to what you meant by, or what Kareem meant, or what anyone meant by, you play with your soul, and I wanted to kind of get a working definition. I think you kind of assumed we all knew what it meant, and we all kind of did, I guess, but it would have been helpful to know how you were using it in this speech. So, when you watch yourself tonight on TV, you're going to see that you're still steepling. So you want to cut that out of your repertoire and let your hands be by your side just and not steeple, because it puts off your audience. Um, Well, let's take the example of Mike Tyson. You told us that he came from a poor background and he learned to fight. What I didn't get was, the soul dimension of his fighting and the soul part of his...
I guess it emphasizes enough of him being the youngest champion at the age of 20 years old.
Uh-huh.
Basically him not having parents.
I see. And that was from his soul.
Yeah.
I see. And then Edward Snowden, the same kind of thing. Why is what he did from his soul and not his body? And because his body's going to be in jail someday, but his soul or his conscience will be free. I just wasn't sure what the argument was.
That there was this internal conflict between his belief system, what is right and what is wrong, and what he was thinking is his job.
Yes.
Of surveilling people. So I was saying that whenever you accomplish a certain task, you're not accomplishing it only with your body. In Snowden's case, it was his intelligence and brain, because he was a pretty smart agent. I mean, it's also his body. Oh, it's also his soul, which is represented by his belief system.
Okay, so the soul is his belief system now. Okay, good. And then finally, the last one, Beethoven. I thought I could see in the last part of his life when he was deaf that took real inspiration to continue to compose. And I guess you're saying came from the soul, and not, cause there was no body or tone to.
Yeah, because he was not able to hear. It's really fascinating how he came up with music.
Yeah. Okay, got it. All right. You sort of lost your train of thought at the end, but that was okay. You got the job done, and I just wish you had made the soul part clear in your analysis, but good job. Thank you. Okay, that brings us to round two. Do. Lindsay Allen.
Just
scratched you out. Do. John Alamy. He's already up there. Boy, he's raring to go. Hi, John. How you doing?
Yeah,
a bit warm. You wanna? I bet it's quiet enough we can open the front door again. With a blue bucket. Sever move. Thank you.
Yes.
That's better. Okay, John. Yeah, that's good. John, I'd like to hear you speak on the first one. By Bill Gates, of all people. We all need people who will give us feedback. That's how we improve. Bill Gates said, we all need people who will give us feedback. That's how we improve.
All right, hi guys, my name's John.
Hi, John.
And so I want to go back to elementary school and middle school. We had to do peer editing for our essays a lot. You know, we'd write our essays and give it to someone else, they'd correct it. Unfortunately for me, I was very lazy. I just never really read other people's papers. I just looked at, like, periods and, you know, apostrophes. I never really looked too deep into it. But now, when I reflect, 10 years later, I realized how important that process of evaluating essays were. And so that's going to bring me to the quote we're going to talk about today. So Bill Gates said that we all need feedback, or no, excuse me, we all need people who can give us feedback, that's how we improve. Okay, we need feedback, that's how we improve, by Bill Gates. To me, this is such a significant quote, because if you can understand the meaning of this, which to me, it means that you need to be able to take in other people's perspectives. You know, other people, they have a different view, whatever it may be, just be able to take it in, absorb it, and then decide if you want to apply it or not. And so I think that's so important, because if you stay in school, you work on a project, professor will give you advice. You go into the job world, you could be a salesman, you might get advice on your tactic. It's very important to be able to take in advice and this kind of feedback and apply it into your life. So I'm going to go into a couple examples today. Three examples. We'll be talking about my experiences in a dance studio, President and Commander-in-Chief Trump's recent travel ban, and third, we'll be looking at what we've been doing in this class for the last 10 weeks. So first thing I want to talk about is I enjoy the occasional dance, ballroom dance. There is a dance studio near me where I live, and I watch people there because I just like to see their progress and see how they go. And it's very interesting because one of the instructors, you know, tells 40s and 50-year-olds they love to dance and get into that kind of thing, you know, with their partners. So they say, hey, guys, I need you to raise your hip. And when you tell that to a lot of people, kinesthetically, they're not going to be able to be aware, raise my hip. And when they raise their hip like this, not only does it look attractive or sexy as the dance is supposed to be for either guys or girls, it just doesn't work. So they needed feedback. What the instructor did was, he said, tighten one leg muscle and loosen the other. And what this does is it naturally lifts one hip up. And that kind of feedback from someone else to give you that kind of kinesthetic adjustment is really something that can be applied for something physical, kind of art-related, like dancing. Now, the second thing I want to go to happened just recently with President Commander-in-Chief, Mr. Trump. So Trump, you know, he got into office, he was inaugurated, he was super excited, you know, he's going to get this travel ban out there, people are going to love me, I'm going to protect the country, it's going to be great, super excited for that. Unfortunately, though, there were some issues, okay? We had some innocent people getting tucked into some rooms. We had a lot of issues with green cards, and it just wasn't a smooth process. So what did President Trump do a couple of weeks later? He said, okay, we're going to get rid of Iraq. That's an ally. We're not going to ban them. We're going to do a 10-day delay so that people won't be as upset when we do the ban. And then we're going to do allow people with green cards. Okay, that's really something special right there. So what he does with that is, he took the advice from people around him. I don't know, maybe he took Kellyanne Conway's advice, who knows, he took maybe Jared Kushner. He took in their advice, and he really listened to them. And so he took feedback and made a product that was better than before, in comparison. So, now I want to go to the third example. It's what we've been doing in this class the last 10 weeks. So, we've been working on speeches, right? We've been doing things we either may not know about our hands, about our voice. You know, we may not know about our tonality or things like that. But what's very important is while we do these things, we have others to give us feedback because they have a different mental filter than us. So they see things that we may not feel, just like the dancers did or that Mr. Trump didn't see. So I remember after my first speech, Professor Miller gave very good advice about the meaning of certain parts of my speech, how I presented them, all these very critical things that I absorbed and decided to implement. So I think after 10 weeks, what we've been doing with speeches is so indicative of being able to absorb feedback, not reject it, but absorb it, and decide if you want to implement it. And that's what I think is so great that we've been able to do within this class. So we've seen through three examples why being able to take in feedback allows us to improve. Okay, Bill Gates' exact quote, we all want people to give us feedback, that's how we improve. We saw through my experiences in a dance studio, and we saw with Trump's President Banner-Chief Trump's recent travel ban and with what we've been doing in this class the last 10 weeks. So I really want you guys just to remember, after the speech, whatever medium you may be, if you hear something and someone says, hey, can I give you a pointer? Don't assume what it is. Don't block it out immediately. Just let it flow, absorb it, and decide if you want to implement it. Thank you.
Okay, where are we? We're here.
Hi, I'm Ryan.
Hi, Ryan. Stand up for Buddha.
Well, I liked the speech very much. I liked how you specifically mentioned your last one and tied it back to that.
Yeah.
I kind of got lost in the middle because the examples were all over the place. But they did pertain to the quote itself, so I thought it was a great speech.
Thank you, Ryan.
Hi, I'm Erin.
Hi, Erin.
I agree that you had a great speech, and I really liked your intonation. You kind of made jokes out of it at a certain time. I thought that was really clever. But I also agree that I think your examples could have related back to the quote in a more concrete way that was like easier to follow, kind of. So,
yeah.
But it was a good speech.
Time was 5:48.
What is time?
5:48,
yeah. It's a wise person that seeks feedback to the end of their dying day, really. One of my best debaters who went on to become the dean of the law school at the University of Michigan, even in his senior year, would come to me and after winning a tournament and saying, Professor Miller, how can I have done better in that round. And even under those conditions, you know, there was still an attitude of, I seek your advice, I want to learn more, I want more feedback, I want more perspective, because I know I'm not perfect, and I know I seek the perspective of others. So I think that you captured that in a way with the importance of feedback. I agree, we got a little lost with the narrative in the middle, which could have been highlighted. The dance was interesting, so the moving the hips, and that was a good example of getting feedback and learning from it. I couldn't tell whether President Trump had learned from Kellyanne or not, or what your conclusion was on that. So I didn't know if you concluded he improved from the feedback or if he even got any. But anyway, that's neither here nor there. And then finally, I of course loved your third example, yeah. your summary, your conclusion, and tie back were good. You could have been a little longer, a little bit more meat on the bone. But you got the idea, the essence of the quote down. There's more. You wanted to say something about Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation and giving away their fortune and curing polio and seeking the advice of great experts on how to give away and use their money. Just a thought. But anyway, nice job. Thank you.
Thank you. Professor?
Yes.
What?
Would it be okay if I went next? Well, it's not fair to the people that I've been calling on. But, you know, what do the rest of you say? Hell no?
You didn't let me do it.
Didn't let her do it. Okay. Didn't let him do it. So I guess that'd be a big no, huh? Sorry, gotta be fair. Okay, back to reality. Back to page one. Oh, jo-jo-jo. Oh, wait, I'm on the wrong way. Oh, jo-jo-jo. Oh, jo-jo-jo. Jo-jo-jo. Eric Renslow. Is there an Eric Renslow in the house?
Yes.
You want to be a man and a gentleman and give your spot to her?
You don't have to spell it down.
What say you?
Well, it'd be a gentlemanly thing to do, but you know, that kind of stuff is dead.
Would it be chivalrous?
Yeah, it'd be chivalrous.
It'd
be good karma. You'd be on my good list.
Well, even though I wanted to, I haven't met you.
Thank you.
Can I go after her then?
What?
If someone's going to be a gentleman, can I go after her then?
No. So who am I doing here?
Emily Hughes.
Emily Hughes, where are you?
It's the final page.
Which round?
I think it's the final one.
Final round?
I think so.
Okay. Emily Hughes. No. Vidya, Marcos, Aaron, Joshua, Monique, Vincent, Serena, Laura, Emily Hughes, you were round two. Okay, hang on a minute. Okay, research brief. Can you put this on the research brief pile? This is stamp two. This goes in. Okay. Oh, bad news. Battery change.